And a very pleasant good evening, everyone, and welcome to Langhorst Field and Blue Jay football as Scotty Williams, Joe Furco, and the rest of the Blue Jays take on the University of Chicago Maroons. Glad to have you logged on to BlueJayTV.com. Mark Krueger along with former Blue Jay defensive back Tony Minestra. And Tony, I guess the main thing tonight is a possible record-breaking evening from Scotty Williams.
Well, we're getting closer here on the Williams watch, as we like to call it.
Won the coin toss and have elected to defer.
229 yards last week. Scotty Williams has moved into second place on Elmhurst's career rushing yardage list, past George Donald. Now with 3,545 yards, he'll need 17 tonight. I think he can get there, Mark.
I think so with what he's been doing so far this year. By the way, Elmhurst 2-0 coming into this one. University of Chicago 1-1. The Blue Jays have won the toss. They have elected to defer. So they will kick off here to start the ball game. Dee Brizzolara, we'll talk about him all night. He is the deep man back for the Maroons.
Yeah, and Brizzolara is the key player last year for the Maroons. 7 catches, 146 yards, 2 touchdowns. Also returned a punt for a score last year in the Maroons' upset of the Jays.
From the goal line, Brizzolara gets across the 20, and he gets tackled down at the 23-yard line. So a 23-yard return. And that's where the Maroons will take over here, first and 10. Yeah, Brizzolara had that punt return was like a minute and a half remaining in that ball game against the Blue Jays last year to propel the Maroons to that victory. Prior to that game, Elmhurst won the previous 8 meetings between these two teams. So out comes Kevin Shelton, the quarterback for the Maroons. Set up in the I formation here. First play from scrimmage from Langhorst Field in Elmhurst. And the give is to the featured back. That's Zach Ross Nash. And he will get close to the 30-yard line. They'll spot it at the 29-yard line. Ross Nash last year rushed for 473 yards. This year, 24 carries, 120 yards. The 5-yard pickup, so it'll bring up a second down and 5 situation here for the Maroons.
Yeah, and the Maroons have a couple of options in the backfield. They can also use an Ian Gaines. He has 42 carries for 243 and a touchdown. So a double-headed attack out of the backfield for the Maroons.
Second down and 5 here for the Maroons. Opening drive of the contest, and again, it is Ross Nash, but he goes nowhere. Met at the line of scrimmage, may have gotten a yard. They're going to spot it at the 30. It's going to bring up third down and 4.
Very important that the Jays get out strong here on defense. The previous 2 weeks, in Loris in week 1 and Trine last week, 2 very long sustained drives by the opponents against the Jays. Last week, Trine ended up scoring. The Jays turned away Loris in their first game, but to get off the field in 3 plays is a big deal tonight for the Jays.
Up front defensively for the Blue Jays, Dan Vicari, Justin Phipps, big number 96 is over the nose, and Charlie Roberts, a good defensive line here for the Blue Jays. Third down and 4 yards to go. Again, it's Ross Nash, and he will get the first down as he gets tackled at the 37-yard line. He'll pick up 6 and a first down.
Chicago's found something they like off the right side of their offensive line. It's a pretty veteran line, Mark. 4 seniors back for the Maroons, and their right tackle is a sophomore, so a lot of veteran savvy up front for Chicago.
Yeah, that's Isaac Stern, the right tackle, the sophomore, and you're right. All the other offensive linemen are back. Dalton Person, Matt Gallery, Mike Van Roten, and John Tabish, the left tackle. Experienced offensive line for the Maroons. And they've got it first and 10 now from their own 38. And this time it's the fullback. This is number 32, Tom Brutofsky. And he spins around to the 45. He'll pick up 7. It'll bring up second down and 3. So, Tony, the Maroons running the ball effectively here in the early going.
And this has been the method that both the first 2 non-conference opponents against the Blue Jays have played out here in the first 2 games. The Blue Jays on defense are very athletic, very quick to the football, but not as physical at the point of attack as you might like. So in this young season, the defensive line and really the front 7 and as a whole has really got to show up here.
Sam Coleman split out to the top of your screen. Again, still that I formation for the Maroons. And this is Ross Nash, the ball carrier, right back to the line of scrimmage. That'll be about it. Actually, a loss on the play as they bring it back to the 44.
Great play that time by Ryan Johnson. He's a senior back there for the Jays. He's kind of a swing player, plays a little outside linebacker, roll down safety. He'll go to the strength of the formation, force the play that time, sets up a third and four.
Linebackers Wayne Tuckson, he's a good one. George DeMaria, Brian Bonds. Secondary for the Blue Jays, Jamal Lane, Stephen Ritter, Ryan Johnson, Alec Giles, and Brandon Westergaard. Third down and four, Maroons from their own 44, showing blitz on the Blue Jays. And again, it's on the ground. Once again, it's Ross Nash, and he will get tripped up short of that first down marker. They're going to be short by about a yard and a half. And the punting unit comes in. So a nice job by the Blue Jay defense as they get a good hand by this crowd here at Elmhurst.
Yeah, the defense knows what they have on the other side of the football. I mean, the Blue Jay offense is going to score points. They're averaging 440 yards a game in this young season, over 30 points a game. And they were 15th in the country, Mark, last year in total offense for the Jays. So the defense just really needs to hold their water and make sure that they can do their part.
Jeff Sauer's punt goes out of bounds. Sauer, by the way, a very good punter, averaging just about 41 yards per punt this season. And the Blue Jays' first offensive attack will start first and 10 from their own 21-yard line. So out comes Joe Furco, the 6'1", 200-pound senior. Boy, it seems like we've been calling his name forever over the years. I tell you.
Well, it took him two games into his freshman year to really take hold of this starting position, and he hasn't let it go. We mentioned Scotty Williams in the opening, and we'll touch on him again here, but Joe Furco has some records he has in his sights as well.
Exactly. We'll touch on those numbers as well. Scotty Williams is a lone setback, and he'll get the carry as he gets tripped up across the 25 to the 26-yard line. It'll be a pickup of five, so the Williams watch, it's about 12 yards right now. Scotty
Williams, the ball carrier. Well, unbelievable. How about these numbers last week against Trine? 60 carries for the Blue Jay offense, 319 yards. Williams had 35 of those carries for 229. But just a commitment to the ground game behind this incredibly talented, versatile, and very experienced offensive line.
Second down, 6 yards to go. Williams, and this time he goes nowhere. A host of Maroons in to bring him down. It's going to bring a third down in about five. Spot at the 26, Tony.
What's most remarkable about what the Blue Jays do on offense is everybody in the stadium knows who's getting the football. It's number 20, and it's been that way for the better part of the last three or four seasons. But this offensive line is able to execute. Coach Tim Lester has done a great job of putting in packages that support the athletes that he has in the backfield, and they're still able to compete at a high level.
Corey Tunn and Jeff Deagle are back to the bottom of your screen. A little flare out there to Williams, and he'll have the first down as he gets across the 30 and shoved out of bounds at the 34. It'll be first and 10 Blue Jays. They set that one nice up nicely, Tony.
Yeah, and then that offensive line, a little shaky on that play, but as a whole, this is the strength of this offensive unit, and maybe as the football program overall. Charlie Homoki, Adam Connors, Chris Kirkpatrick, Peter Stamos, and Adam Smith, four of those starters are back from a year ago.
Yeah, just like for the University of Chicago, four starters back on their offensive line. For the Blue Jays, four starters back on their offensive line. Pitch, here's Williams. And looks like they're going to mark him out of bounds close to the 40-yard line. He'll pick up four on that play. Spotted right at the 40-yard line.
Scotty Williams, the ball carrier, picks up six on the play.
6 yard pickup on that play for Scotty Williams. Second down and four now. Tunn and Deagle are split out to the bottom of your screen here. Vince Gabry's going in motion. The give once again is to Williams, and as he tries to cut back up, he may have slipped a little bit and got tackled right at the 40-yard line. No gain.
Well, right now, University of Chicago is getting penetration. It's this inside zone running game. That time it was Michael Sefor, the junior nose tackle for Chicago. And if you can get penetration against this offensive line, and especially against this zone rushing attack, it forces the issue for Scotty. It doesn't allow him to cut back against the grain.
No score, opening quarter. Blue Jays and the Maroons here from Langhorst Field. Blue Jays face a third down and four. Furco has time, throws, fires, and it is incomplete, intended for the freshman Jeff Deagle. Nice defensive play, and it'll bring up fourth down.
Bang, bang play. Looked like the corner got there right at the time the ball arrived. Jeff Deagle, a freshman, inserted into the starting lineup for the Blue Jays tonight, not able to make the play on third down.
Furco's pass incomplete to Deagle, broken up by Beltrano on the play.
So both teams will punt. Brizolara is the lone man back for the Maroons.
Well, here's Brizolara. They'll try to keep it away from him. Broke the Jays back last year.
Yeah.
77-yard punt return. Broke open a 26-all tie.
Sean Sullivan to punt it away here for the Blue Jays. And we've got a whistle.
So looking back to last year, it's been a long 365 days, and this is the last of the non-conference schedule for the Blue Jays. Chicago did snap an eight-game winning streak that the Jays had had over the Maroons. Elmhurst outgained Chicago last year by 200 yards, Mark.
200 yards. Incredible. They outgained them, yeah.
But turned the ball over four times.
Well, that's, yeah, you can't do that.
Yep, not able to make plays in the last couple of minutes of the game. And
5-yard walk-off against the Blue Jays. So Sullivan now, the pretty decent punt. Brizolara will move up, and he'll catch it at his own 29. Across the 40, and he's brought down at the 44-yard line. 15-yard return for Brizolara, and the Maroons will set up shop first and 10 from their own 44 on their second offensive possession of the night. Actually, they're going to mark it at the 45-yard line.
Decent effort by the Jays defense on their first round tonight.
Chicago takes over first and referee tonight, Tony, I'm sorry, Jim Wojciechowicz. The umpire, Kyle Hastings. The linesman, Ryan Fitzsimmons. Line judge is Chuck Graber. Side judge is Sergio De Hayes. Back judge is Phil Way. And the field judge is Marcel Kurz. Kevin Shelton and the Maroons, first and 10 from their own 45. That I formation. Ross Nash breaks it, and he's into the Blue Jay territory inside the 40, and they're going to mark it at the 39. 16-yard pickup for Zach, and a first down for the Maroons.
Well, Chicago's head coach Dick Maloney and his offensive staff have found something they like on the ISO play to the backside of the formation. They're shifting their tight end, moving Ryan Johnson, the swing safety, to the other side of the field, coming backside with the ISO.
Game time temperature, a gorgeous 78 degrees.
Just an incredible day. Great night for football.
Slight breeze out of the east. They say about 6 miles an hour, but just ideal weather conditions. The lights will take effect here in probably the second half of this one. Ross Nash will go nowhere as he tried to cut it back the best he could, but right there was Wayne Tuckson to bring him down.
Wayne's been the rock on this side of the football for the Jays for the last couple of seasons. All-conference performer, leading tackler. And that's where the Jays are at their best, Mark, when they can run sideline to sideline. Tuckson and DeMaria and the rest of the Jays on defense, very athletic.
Yes. And quick, side to side. All right, we got a second down and 12 situation here. Loss of two for the Maroons. No score here. 6:35 remaining here in the first quarter. Shelton with a little play action over here to Brizolara, and he did bring it down at the 32. It's going to be about 3 yards short of the first down.
A little bit of a new look for the Blue Jays this year on defense. They're using a two-high safety look almost exclusively every down, forcing teams to be patient, work it underneath, maybe go to the running game a little bit more. They gave up a lot of big plays last year, maybe a little more conservative approach this year on the defensive side of the football for defensive coordinator Joe Adam.
Third down, 4 yards to go from the 33. Jamal Lane, single coverage on Brizolara. And they hand it off to the fullback, Bratovsky. He's not going to get it.
You see Jamal Lane come in off his corner spot to upend the fullback. Goodness gracious.
Great play. Well, they're going to mark it at the 31. So it would be about a 48-yard field goal attempt.
Sauer was good. Their kicker, Jeff Sauer, is 4 for 4.
Yeah, he's got the
extra
leg,
points,
Tony.
6 of 7 field goals, and he's hit a 42-yarder.
But it looks like they're going to go for it. So they will pass up the field goal attempt and go for it here. Kind of a big play here early. 5 minutes to go, first quarter. 4th and 2, Maroons, and there's a timeout taken by Chicago, and they will talk things over. Dick Maloney, the head coach in his 19th season as the head coach of the Maroons, burns a timeout. Well, believe it or not, Tony, this is only the second game here at Langhorst Field played under the lights.
Yep.
Remember, we were here last year.
Yeah, Olivette was in town.
Yeah.
I mean, that game got away pretty quickly.
64-14 was the final of that. That was fun.
It was. It was a lot of fun. But I'll tell you, the advantage with the lights, it gives you some flexibility in the football schedule, but it also allows you to play some other sports during the evening hours, the soccer and lacrosse in the spring as well. But it also offers opportunities for the youth teams, the high schools in the area. So it's a very positive experience. It's been the campus has been a buzz with a lot of different programs all fall.
Final scores: North Central 37, Wisconsin South 10, Wheaton 53.
So after the University of Chicago calling a timeout here, we'll see what they do here. 4th down and 2. Scoreless ball game so far. 5:07 remaining here in the opening quarter.
I'd be surprised if they didn't just try to run it off tackle right downhill.
Ross Nash, he gets the call. He's not going to get it.
I don't think he got it, Mark.
He didn't even get to the 30. He had to get to the 29. What a stop by the Blue Jay defense.
Yep. Well, this Maroon offensive line had something good going here in the early going. They really leaned on him that time. Jays responded.
And so out comes Joe Furco in this Blue Jay offense for the second time tonight.
We'll see if Coach Lester lets Furco open it up here, turn the field position back over here.
This Blue Jay offense has been unbelievable in the first two games, averaging 440 yards of offense per game.
Well, incredibly efficient, 9 for 9 in the red zone.
Yeah.
And almost 60% on third down, so they have just been clicking on all cylinders.
And they're going to run, it's an inside handoff right there.
Lindahl on that one.
Think about the red zone too, Tony. You mentioned how successful they were. Nine of nine perfect inside the in the red zone. But the difference is that the Blue Jays are scoring touchdowns in the red zone, whereas the Maroons are settling for field goals.
Yeah.
4 yard pickup, so 2nd down and 6 yards to go here now for Furco. Here's Williams, trying to get to the outside. He does, stiff arms across the 40, and close to midfield, and that should
do it. That'll
do it. Scotty Williams is your all-time career rushing leader here at Elmhurst. Unofficially, of course. Let's put that in there. They spot him out of bounds at the 46-yard line.
Scotty Williams with the carry for the Blue Jays, picks up 12 yards.
First and 10. There it is. Yeah, 12-yard pickup, so that will do it.
All-time leading rusher on that play.
Big round of applause as Kevin Judé, the public address announcer, telling everybody what Scotty Williams has just done.
33, solo tackle, this guy right here.
Getting that inside handoff.
Well, getting to know Scotty over the last couple of years and his family as well, I know that Scotty's the last one who's going to beat his chest and want any special recognition. He's quite a humble young man, incredible citizen, great student. He's an All-American in the classroom. Just the kind of kid that you want in your program, and he's just going to keep grinding away here.
He's the lone setback here for Joe Furco and the Blue Jays. 2nd down and 7 now from their own 49-yard line. Here he is again. Cross midfield, 45, cuts back, 40.
Oh, boy.
He could be gone. Scotty Williams is gone. 51 yards and a Blue Jay touchdown, no flags.
The Maroons are committing 8 and 9 white jerseys to the box. That time Scotty cuts it back. They're going to need to put 10 or 11 down there to stop number 20.
51 yards to the Elmhurst touchdown.
So the Blue Jays strike first here. 3:19 remaining here in the opening quarter.
What's incredible about this offensive scheme for the Blue Jays, and it's very simple, Mark, a lot of zone blocking schemes. It allows Williams 3 points of attack. He can take it up in the intended hole, cut it back, or bounce it outside. He's got a three-way go on it. He's got great vision as well.
And the extra point by Thomas is good, and it is now 7-0 in favor of the Blue Jays. Tony mentioned this is the final non-conference game of the season for Elmhurst. They'll have a well-deserved bye week next week as they get geared up for CCIW play. And in 2 weeks from tonight, there'll be their conference opener against Coach Thorne and the Cardinals of North Central in Naperville.
Yeah,
so that'll be
Benedetti.
A big test.
Absolutely.
Yeah, big
but
test.
You have to play North Central. They're in your conference. But if you want to set them up anywhere, how about game one after 2 weeks to prepare?
right?
Couldn't
right.
have set up much better for the Jays.
Yeah.
And this game here tonight, I was talking to some of the players before the game and in the week leading up. They've really had this one circled. You wouldn't think University of Chicago would be a big game, but a lot of the seniors were extremely disappointed with what happened in Hyde Park last year. And they all knew coming into tonight that they were going to get a game out of the Maroons, and they had a little bit of revenge on their mind as well.
Yeah, especially, as you mentioned, all those seniors and how that game ended last year, the final minute with Brizolero returning that punt. A little payback here for the Blue Jays, hopefully. 3:19 remaining here in this opening quarter. If you've just logged on to BlueJayTV.com, we appreciate it. Mark Krueger along with Tony Minestra bringing you exciting Blue Jay football here at Langhorst Field. We just saw Scotty Williams with a 51-yard touchdown run to give the Blue Jays the lead here, 7-0.
Well, in the young season, two games in, Elmhurst has really just overwhelmed opponents, averaging 33.5 points a game in their two contests so far. How about only 6.5 points on the other side? The defense has been a unit that struggled at points last year, but much improved, some schematic changes this year. A lot of the faces are back a year older, year stronger, year wiser. So if that defense can hang this year, look out.
Yeah, that's going to be a key, Tony, no question about it. I don't think there's any question that this Blue Jay offense is going to be scoring a ton of points this season. And I don't care who you're playing, but you're right. If that defensive unit can come together, this could be a magical year for the Blue Jays. So we're ready to go here. Brizolara is the man deep for the Maroons. Good high, deep kick. Brizolara from his own 1 yard line.
Great coverage.
And he just does dive forward to the 18-yard line. So a 17-yard return for Brizolara. And for the third time tonight, that's where the Maroon offense will go back to work.
18. Field position is turned over. It's such a big part of the game. It doesn't show up in the stat line. But having to go 80 and 70 yards rather than 50 or 40, big deal.
Well, Ian Gaines now is the featured back. He's a tailback in there now for the Maroons. First and 10 from their own 18-yard line, and Gaines does indeed get the call, and he gets tripped up at the 20-yard line. Pickup of a couple. Second down and 8 yards to go here for Chicago.
You'll see some shuffling in and out for the Jays on defense. They like to keep their defensive line fresh. Charlie Roberts, Justin Phipps, and Dan Vicari are your primary starters, but you'll see a little bit of Eric Vincent, Chris Reed, some other names will work their way in and out of the lineup tonight.
Actually, a 3 yard pickup for Gaines, so it's going to be 2nd and 7 from the 21-yard line. Shelton throwing here to the near side, and this one's going to be picked off. Jamal Lane.
Number 2 on the young season for Jamal.
This pass is intercepted by Jamal Lane.
Well, he had excellent coverage on Brizolara, but Tony, to be honest, that wasn't the best thrown ball in the world either.
Not at all. Little sprint out pass. They go high-low with it. Quarterback that time. Shelton got a little bit impatient. Jamal Lane's one of those seniors we referenced. He's been around a while. Right. He started really since his freshman year. Very aggressive player.
So we'll see if the Blue Jays can capitalize on the Lane interception. First and 10 from the 41. Furco has time going deep in the end zone.
Got it.
Touchdown. That's Corey Tan. Whoa, my. 41 yards from Furco to Corey Tan.
Great shot by Furco. Put it right over top of the defender. Pretty good coverage that time by the Maroons. But Corey Tan went up and got it. And he's not that big a guy. Corey Tan listed at 5'8", 170. Just positions himself very well that time. Outstanding throw by Furco.
Corey Tan out of Wheaton North High School. His Wheaton North Falcons are having a very good year so far, undefeated on the season. And in for his second extra point, Thomas, and it is good. Actually, no good. I'm sorry. So it's 13 to nothing. Extra point, no good. 2:21 remaining. 13 to nothing in favor of the Blue Jays.
Great throw, obviously, by Joe, and incredible protection that time by the offensive line.
We see that a lot, Tony.
Yep.
After a penalty, go for the downs.
Sure.
Go for it all. And that worked for Elmhurst beautifully.
Well, a lot of things you call on offense and the strategy you take forward from a play calling standpoint has to do with the trust that you have, the trust level you have with your quarterback, with your offensive line. And 4 years now, Joe Furco's worked with Coach Lester, and they're really connected. They're able to communicate very quickly at times, and obviously the trust level that Lester has for Furco is there.
That's a great point. Mm-hmm. Yeah, in his fourth year now, Furco knows this offense like the back of his hand, and you're right, Lester, I'm sure, has so much respect and so much, you know, he trusts him out there. That's that trust factor.
And Lester, you know, a dynamite quarterback in his own right, so he's a pretty tough critic.
That's taken by one of the up men, and he just wisely just kind of dives on it. That's number 35 for University of Chicago. That's Miguel Maceda. So the ball is spotted at their own 27, where it'll be first and 10 Maroons here with 2:15 to go here in the opening quarter.
Well, we'll see what the Maroons are made of here, down two scores here suddenly with some promise in the early going. Still here in the first quarter now. The offense is going to need to respond.
Ian Gaines in there at the tailback position. Ross Nash had some nice runs early on. He's not in the ball game right now. It's Gaines, the ball carrier. Gaines spins across the 30 to the 32-yard line, a 5-yard pickup. It'll bring up second down and 5.
One of the advantages to using two high safety shell as the Jays are doing this season, it is allowing Giles and Ritter, the two safeties, to come downhill and force in the run game. So the linebackers are able to string the play out and the safeties can clean it up.
Second and 5 for the Maroons on their own 32.
Rizzolera split out here to the near side. Second and 5 from their own 32, trailing 13 to nothing. The draw to Ian Gaines, and Ian will get maybe a yard to the 33, and it's going to bring up third down and call it 4 here for the Maroons.
George DeMaria, the crafty middle linebacker, sticking his nose in there. 5'11", 205, but plays with great leverage, great vision.
It's like Charlie Roberts took himself out of the ballgame. Looks like they're looking at his right hand there, it looks like, Tony. But hopefully he'll be okay and back into that defensive unit soon. Third down, 3 yards, call it here for the Maroons from their own 34. Less than a minute to go here in the opening quarter. Shelton, quick hit, tipped, and it is incomplete. Intended receiver, Miguel Maceda, number 35.
Well, they went 5 wide, did the Maroons, and the Jays brought more than they could block. DeMaria got right in the grill of Kevin Shelton, disrupted the play.
DeMaria with the pressure for the Blue Jays.
Jeff Sauer will punt it away here. Tyler Smith is back deep for the Blue Jays.
Sauer on the punt for the Maroons.
See if Ritter gets a chance here. Nope.
Well, for the second time, Sauer punts it out of bounds into the Maroon sidelines. It'll be first and 10 Blue Jays, and they're going to spot it at their own 36-yard line.
So far, so good for the Elmhurst defense. They have a lot to be happy about as they make their way to the sideline here.
The Blue Jays take over first and 10.
So for the Blue Jays, first and 10 from their own 36-yard line, leading 13 to nothing. 43 seconds to go here in the opening quarter. Furco, inside handoff to Williams. He's got room as he plows over one defender across the 40 to the 42. He'll pick up six. Second and four.
Little new wrinkle the Blue Jays are using this year. Little wide sweep. Kind of an outside zone look. Gets the defense running side to side.
And the Blue Jays are not going to run another play as the whole unit comes over to their sideline here as the clock is just going to wind down here. And that will be the end of the first quarter. Blue Jays leading it at the end of one by a score of 13 to nothing. And Tony, so far so good. We've seen some good offense. We've seen a pick by Jamal Lane. Both sides of the ball doing well.
Yeah, they come out focused. You know, I had no doubts coming into this game that they had it circled. Coaches have them ready. Sometimes before a bye week, you worry if the focus is going to be there. But the Jays have come out clicking on all cylinders.
First half numbers. Scotty Williams, 7 carries, 80 yards. Of course, he had that 51-yard touchdown run. So he's well on his way to having another outstanding ball game.
Well, we mentioned Scotty in the opening. Obviously, he'll get many mentions moving forward, but we also alluded to what Joe Furco is doing as a passer.
Right.
He's currently fourth all-time in career pass attempts. He's third all-time in career pass completions, which he has a great shot of getting to this year. He's only 60 away there. But career passing yardage, Mark, comes in tonight with 6,200, tacked a few more tonight. He only needs 200 yards to become the Blue Jays' all-time leading passer in terms of yardage.
Keep an eye out for that as well. First play of the second quarter is a handoff to Scotty Williams. We've got a flag here on the play, and this one is going to be against the Blue Jays, and this one will come back.
Williams, the ball carrier.
And Chris Kirkpatrick, Boo Kirkpatrick, the anchor of that offensive line, the senior center is down.
Yeah, you don't like to see that. That's the right tackle, Adam Smith, guilty of the infraction, and Kirkpatrick limping, well, noticeably, but hopefully he'll be okay.
Chris is really the emotional leader, the vocal leader of this offense. Seems to be doing okay getting off the field. Here comes Josh Williams.
You just logged on. We certainly thank you for doing that. BlueJayTV.com. Mark Krueger along with Tony Minestra. It's 13 to nothing in favor of the Blue Jays.
So this is your Mustang package here. Your Downers Grove South with the two Williams brothers in
right
together.
Yeah, I was just going to say, Scotty's younger brother, Josh Williams, number 26 in there. Josh, a freshman.
Uh-oh. False start. Number 73.
Yeah. Well, that's Adam Smith again.
Well, what's unfortunate about that is the Coach Lester and the Blue Jays showed their hand there a little bit. Look, they were coming with a reverse to Furco, possibly a reverse pass on that play.
Well, here we go again. Wildcat action going on here. Josh Williams, the younger brother of Scotty in there, number 26. Furco split out to the top. Williams will take it, keep it himself, and another flag as Williams may have gotten a yard, but we'll see what the penalty markers are all about.
They may actually get Furco that time for a block in the back. He's out there, the slot receiver.
Block in the back. Number seven.
You're right, Tony.
Yep.
You're exactly right. Boy, three penalties right in a row. This is killing the Blue Jays on this drive.
Well, we didn't see Josh in uniform in week one out in Dubuque, but we did see quite a bit of him against Trine. He had a limited playbook, ran about six or seven plays. Most of it came out of what kind of looks like the Wildcat, the two Williams brothers in there together. So as he gets more comfortable in this offense, keep in mind, he didn't join the student body until the second week of school this fall.
He started out at Whitewater.
Exactly.
And just didn't fit in well there, didn't like it.
Right.
It's great to see him here at Elmhurst.
Yeah, and he's really still coming along. He's maturing as a football player as well.
Second down, 29 yards to go. It's Williams the ball carrier, and he will get to the 24. He'll get seven of those yards back. It'll bring up third down and, well, third down and about 22.
Blue Jays self-destructing, really hurting themselves on this play, this drive.
Yeah, you got to keep the pedal to the metal, Tony. You can't, you know, you make those mistakes, and if the Maroons can get a turnover and cash in, they're right back in this ballgame.
Mark, what do you got in the playbook for third and 20?
Well, just don't turn the ball over, right? Furco out of the gun. Third and long. Near side, it's Tun, but he's going to be well short of the first down as he falls down at the 32.
And that's actually a very responsible call. You're going to go ahead and set yourself up for a better field position.
Right. Don't want to do anything crazy there.
Live to play another down.
There you go.
Brings up a fourth and 14 for the Blue Jays.
Brizalera trots back out for the Maroons. He is standing at his own 30-yard line.
Back deep for Chicago.
We've mentioned a couple times, he can be a game breaker. Brizalera, fourth year starter for the Maroons.
Sullivan to punt it away here for the Blue Jays. Nearly got it blocked. Brizalera will not catch it. He'll let it go, and it'll take a Blue Jay roll, and it'll go out of bounds at the 27.
Big time break for the guys in the blue jerseys.
Yeah.
I'm surprised that number six didn't field that at the very least on a hop.
Brizalera, by the way, two-time All-North Region player. Two-time University Athletic Association Offensive MVP. Tony, get this. He holds or shares 13 school records.
Hmm. Pretty long storied history at University of Chicago as well. So that's quite an accomplishment.
Shelton goes under center now. Ian Gaines is the lone back, and Gaines will get the ball carry. Ball. Get tripped up at the 29, pick up 2 yards, second down and 8 yards to go as we approach the 12-minute mark of this first half.
Ball carrier, met by Beltrano and Vicari.
Of course, the 2012 version of University of Chicago, a Division III program. But
second and eight for the Maroons.
You'll need to go back into the annals, but they competed to get the Division I level.
Yeah. Back in the way back of the day.
Yeah, before World War II.
Sure. Second down and eight, Maroons from their own 29. Coleman goes in motion, and the ball is tipped at the line of scrimmage, deflected. And it'll be third down. The intended receiver was the tight end Brandon Meckelberg.
U of C looks very disconnected and sort of disorganized in their passing game. The pass protection isn't really holding up all that great, and they're using a lot of three-step quick release type of stuff here.
Yeah, very early on in this ballgame, I thought they were running the ball very effectively with Ross Nash, but I'm not sure if he's injured, but he is out of the ballgame now, and Ian Gaines, the leading rusher for the Maroons, is in there. Shelton looking to his right, quick slant to Brizalera, and he should have the first down, and he does.
Yeah.
Nice route that time by D. Brizalera.
Good connection that time. Brizalera just gets in front of Jamal.
Shelton's pass
able to move the sticks.
Brizalera, four catches for 134 yards and one touchdown last week for the Maroons in their 1-point loss to Concordia of Chicago. First and 10, Maroons from their own 38. Again, out of the eye, it's Gaines, the ball carrier. Gets across the 40, and he gets tripped up at the 42-yard line. About a 4-yard gain that time.
Yeah, there's a good look at the safety coming downhill.
Chicago picks up four. Tackled by Giles on the play.
That time, Ryan Johnson, the outside backer, safety, forced the play. Allowed Giles to get downhill. And we're seeing Justin Phipps now, the big number 96, who plays the zero technique. 6'5", 250, pushed out to end with Charlie Roberts. Apparently still banged up.
Yeah, second down, 6 yards. Linebackers coming up. They show blitz. Gaines gets the ball, and he comes to the outside here and gets shoved out of bounds at the 47. He'll pick up 5. He's going to be a yard short. He'll bring up 3rd down and 1.
New set of linebackers out there for the Jays as we're getting a look at Tyler Demas, Anthony Beltrano, and John Alitas.
Sets up a 3rd and 1 for Chicago.
Yeah, you're right, Tony. Constantly bringing people in, constantly bringing people out, getting fresh bodies in there.
And there's a lot of evaluation still happening here as we get into CCIW play. Who are you going to be your 11 or 12 that are going to contribute on a down-to-down basis? Coach is still using these early season games as a testing ground.
3rd down and 1 yard. Gaines is not going to get it.
Boy, I think Beltrano came through. Looked like number 44
right.
Flashed across your screen that time and knifed into the backfield to force the play.
Yeah, Anthony with the initial hit in the backfield. Yeah, it's going to be a loss.
Gaines, the ball carrier, met by Beltrano in the backfield.
Maybe about of a half a yard. But it's going to bring up a 4th down, and Sauer is going to come in to punt again.
Yeah, got to be careful here, though. Be aware of this fake here at midfield.
Right. 9:14 to go. Sauer indeed does get off a high punt. Oh, the ball is coughed up, but it goes out of bounds, and it will stay Blue Jays ball. Stephen Ritter. Or check that. That's Tyler Smith who coughed the ball up.
Yeah, it was Ritter. He's been very good in the young season. He's 3 returns for an average of almost 18 yards a return. That time just not securing the football high and tight.
Mm. So a break for the Blue Jays. Furco comes out now. 1st and 10 from their own 11. 9:02 to go.
Boo Kirkpatrick back out there anchoring that offensive line at center.
Ton and Deagle are your 2 wideouts here. We'll see what Furco decides to do. 1st and 10 from their own 11.
That's a completed pass.
Little shovel pass.
Yeah, to Vince Gabriels. And Gabriels gets across the 40 to the 41. That's a pickup of 30, and that's a completed pass. Wow, I like that call.
Nice little wrinkle that Coach Lester mixes into the offense that time. Obviously, the defense is very much focused on number 20.
Right.
Get a little cross-mic direction, and Gabris, a very versatile player, comes back across the formation, picks up a big gainer.
Yeah, 30 yards on that little shovel pass to Gabris. That worked beautifully. Uh-oh, now we've got a penalty marker thrown here. And...
before the snap, pause start. Number 73, 5 yards up, first down.
Boy.
Yeah. Adam Smith's having a tough night at that right tackle position.
Well, Adam Smith, 6'5", 300 pounds over on the right side of that offensive line. He's right next to Peter Stamos, a senior, back for his 5th season.
5-yard walk-off, Tony. So it's 1st and 15 now, Blue Jays, from their own 36. Williams straight up the middle, makes a move across midfield, and brought down at the 48-yard line.
Another flag on the far side here. Jays run a little wham play inside, a little quick trap, showing some new wrinkles this week.
Arlen Hill with the tackle for the Maroons. 3 officials standing around the 45-yard line discussing it. Now the Lions judge is coming in. Get the call from Jim Wojciechowicz.
Legal formation on the offense. 6 men in the backfield. 5 are counting for
the previous spot. Well, Coach Lester cannot like what's happening here in the second quarter. Too many penalties.
Yeah, and that's just a simple one. Your receiver not lined up at the line of scrimmage that time. Negates a big play by Scotty. Brings up a 1st and 20.
Just under the 8-minute mark of this first half. 13-0 in favor of the Blue Jays. First and 20 now. The Blue Jays have to get to the Maroon 49-yard line to pick up a first down. Scotty Williams, the ball carrier. Alex Zerbicki, the middle linebacker, was there on the tackle.
Scotty Williams with a 3-yard pickup.
Pickup of three for Williams to the 34-yard line.
Zerbicki, a great job that time, holding his gap. Not allowing Scotty Williams to cut back against the grain, which he has shown he is quite adept at doing as we get another look at the Williams duo.
Second and seven now. And they fake the reverse. Instead, this is Josh Williams who tries to cut to the outside, and he does. Got a little stiff arm there, and he's brought down at the 43. Another wrinkle to this Blue Jay offense.
Well, don't think that Coach Lester and this coaching staff doesn't realize that North Central is going to get this tape and the rest of the CCIW. If you can put something on tape and they have to run a few reps in practice, that's just another thing you have to prepare for in terms of the game planning leading up to the Elmhurst-North Central game.
Well, that's going to bring up third down and eight. I think I said second and seven previously, but I meant second and 17.
Four wide look here. This is new for the Jays as well.
Yeah. Furco out of the shotgun. Third down and eight. Looking left. Throwing left. And it is incomplete.
Going for the big tight end, Will Caspers. We don't see a lot of him in the regular offensive game plan, but he's a good target. 6'2", 210, a sophomore.
So fourth down, Sullivan going to come in and punt it away here for the Blue Jays. 6:24 left to go first half.
So things getting a little sloppy with the penalties. A lot of yellow hankies out there for the Blue Jays. Mm. And the Maroons are just kind of hanging around.
Yeah,
14-0.
They are. Sullivan gets it off. Brizolera will again not attempt to pick it up. Stop at the 22-yard line, first and 10 for the Maroons.
Yeah, and Brizolera is really surprising me here with not fielding the football. He's coming into this game averaging 30 yards of return on punts and almost 45 yards of return on kickoffs.
Yeah, yeah, so he could be a little more aggressive back there, but that hasn't been the case. 6:12 to go. If you just tuned in, Scotty Williams, a 51-yard touchdown run. And then Joe Furco, a 41-yard touchdown pass to Tun. And it's 13-0 Blue Jays. Kevin Shelton and the Maroons back to work now. First and 10. Straight up the middle running goes nowhere. Maybe a yard, but that's about it. That Blue Jay defense up front.
They're just creating a scrum there around the line of scrimmage. Well, it's worth noting, Mark, that Chicago's win last year down in Hyde Park snapped a 28-game September winning streak for the Blue Jays. So a non-conference run that broke last year. So here we are in mid-September looking to build another streak together here.
Draw and going nowhere. Wow. That's going to bring up about a loss of three on the play. Was Ben Clark. He is a freshman. And you have to believe that Ross Nash is injured because he is not playing. Loss of three. So it's going to bring up third down and 13 as the ball is at the Maroons' own 20-yard line.
Last time the Maroons came out with five wide, the Jays answered with pressure. We'll see if they elect to go coverage here.
Shelton, four wide outs.
Bringing heat.
Quick drop and the pass is complete that time to Sam Coleman. And Coleman will get tackled at the 30-yard line. It's going to be short of the first down. And they'll punt it away again.
Shelton made the right decision that time. Receiver sat down. But the Jays are playing a soft umbrella zone behind the blitz. Able to make a play in front of it.
Sauer comes in to punt. I believe this is his sixth punt of the half. 4:24 remaining. 13-0 Blue Jays. Wow, that is excellent open field tackle there by number two, Jacob Romeo. Mm.
Outstanding. Just the gunner beats his man down the field and makes a great play on the football. Again, field position is playing a big part in tonight's game. The Maroons are able to hang around here because they continue to keep the Jays buried back into their own side of the football field.
Let's see if the Blue Jays can put together a nice little attack here with the 4:16 remaining here. Remember, they deferred to start the game, so the Blue Jays will get the ball back to start the third quarter.
Well, they have to reestablish that running game as well here.
Furco, 1st and 10 out of the gun from their own 27. Here's Williams, 30, and he'll get tackled at the 35-yard line, a gain of 8. It'll be 2nd and 2. That's a good start.
Yeah, Scotty did a great job that time securing the football. Ryan Oros, defensive ends for the Maroons, tried to strip it as he brought Williams down to the turf.
Brings up 2nd and 2 for the
Blue Jays have all three of their timeouts remaining, the Maroons with just one. 3:45 to go here in this first half. Furco directing traffic. Again, handing the ball off to Williams. And Williams cannot cut the cut up. Instead, he gets shoved out of bounds at the 36, a gain of 1.
Another hanky there at the hash mark.
There's a flag on the play.
These Maroon defensive linemen are doing a great job at the point of attack.
Third down as they wave off the flag, no flag. I don't think the Maroons have been penalized yet tonight, have they?
Doesn't seem that they have.
I think all the penalties have gone against the Blue Jays.
Been pretty physical on defense as well. Part of the strategy of the zone running game is to almost steer the defender kind of where he wants to go and allow the running back to cut against the grain. But they've been very physical up front, forcing the issue. Been tough to deal with tonight.
Third down and a yard here for the Blue Jays. See what Coach Lester drums up here. They hand it off to Williams. Straight ahead, he'll have the first down. Tough running straight ahead by the senior.
That's a lot of faith in your offensive line. 3rd and 1. 10 down in the box that time. Go ahead and give it to your playmaker. Allow your offensive line to get a push.
Again, if you just logged on, Scotty Williams has become the all-time career rushing leader tonight in Elmhurst history.
Passed a heck of a back, and Eric Luna held the previous mark at 35-61.
1st and 10. Furco does a nice job of getting rid of the football.
Boy, Vince had been better off just to knock the football down, and I think they lost a couple of yards on that one.
Beltrano was applying the pressure to Joe. 2nd down and 10. 2:39 remaining.
Furco's pass complete to Gabries.
Brought a little corner blitz that time and really hurried the throw for Furco. Didn't quite expect it.
2nd down and 12. Blue Jays from their own 36. Furco, he's got a lot of time, and a man wide open here to the near side, close to the 47-yard line. He gets shoved out of bounds. He'll be about a yard short.
Yeah, Joe Sanfilippo that time, a 5'11 freshman. Love to see him anchor down and maybe charge towards that first down marker. He'll learn as he gets along kind of where he's at on the field, but love to see him maybe drop a shoulder and fight for another yard or two.
All right, big play here for the Blue Jays. 3rd and 1 yard, under 2 minutes to go in the first half. Up movement. Boy, oh boy. Could be a number of people out there.
Well, two pretty clean games played by the Jays in weeks 1 and 2. Not so much tonight.
False start. Number 33 in the offense. 5 yards from the previous spot. Third down.
Another false start against the Blue Jays. Pretty well played first quarter, but the second quarter is when we started seeing a lot of the laundry fly out here in the second quarter.
Yeah, and certainly as we get into the halftime here, as we're under 2 minutes, it will be a point that Coach Lester and the coaching staff really hammer home.
So 3rd down and 6 now after the 5-yard walk-off. Williams will get the call. He'll turn it up. He'll have the first down as he gets hit hard out of bounds right around midfield, and that'll stop the clock with 1:22 to go in the half.
Well, the maroon middle linebacker, Brian Duffy, number 44, had a beat on him, but Scotty showed off one of his many talents, and that's speed to the corner. Was able to turn it on, get the edge, and move the sticks.
Well, I know there's tons of talent in the CCIW, Tony, but Scotty Williams certainly has to be one of the lead candidates for Conference Offensive Player of the Year.
Yeah.
If he can stay healthy this year. First and 10 from midfield. Furco across the middle. He's got his man, Ryan McGuire. And McGuire lowers his shoulder and gets tripped up at the 33. 17-yard reception.
Here's a guy, Ryan McGuire. He's bounced defense, offense. He's done whatever the program and the coaching staff has asked him to do. That time makes a play. Caught a touchdown last week. I love he lowers the shoulder on Arlen Hill, the free safety, forcing the contact.
I formation here for the Blue Jays. Just over a minute remaining. Furco on the bootleg. Comes out here and he'll tuck it under. And he'll get inside the 30. And he'll stop the clock with just under a minute remaining.
Well, the Jays do have a weapon in David Thomas, their kicker, that in previous years, maybe not thinking about field goal at this point. He's got a leg to go 50-plus.
Yeah.
So they're certainly in his range at this point.
He was doing that in the pregame warm-ups. He was going from 54, 55 easily. And again, no wind to speak of here tonight in Elmhurst.
Looks like we're getting a look at Richardson now in the backfield.
Second down and 5 from the 27. Furco, straight drop. Now gets flushed out. Still looking, throws, and it's deflected. Incomplete. Jeff Deagle, the freshman receiver, was the intended target. And another penalty marker on the field.
That one's on Joe. He passed the line of scrimmage, it looks like. The flag came out there at about the 25-yard line. Drifted a little too far past. Could have had the first down with his feet.
I thought so, yeah. He had some room ahead of him. There was a lot of room, but he decided to throw the ball. Yep.
Well, you lose a down, and you lose some yardage on that, which is the bigger part of it, as you start to push your kicker further and further back. We're now under a minute to go. Still all 3 timeouts. So the whole field is still in play.
I know, like you said, I know you want a touchdown, but you're looking at around a 46-yard field goal right now. Third and 5.
Getting a look at some young receivers here with Deagle and now Jordan Young, a freshman out of the Minneapolis-St. Paul area, number 86.
Furco comes up to the line of scrimmage, wanted to probably change the play call, and there's going to be a timeout taken by the Blue Jays, their first of 3, so they got 2 more to go. 51 seconds remaining.
Timeout called by Elmhurst. They got 2 left. That's their first of the half.
Well, Blue Jays on a 3-game winning streak here at Langhorst Field. Coach Lester has been pretty good here. 13-9 in home games. 5-1 last year, Mark, and six games at home. They play very well here. The friendly confines of Langhorst Field.
I tell you what, it's a great atmosphere here at Elmhurst. And folks, if you ever get a chance to come out and see the Blue Jays in person, please come on out. It's a lot of fun. It's a great environment.
Some incredible upgrades is obviously the field a couple of seasons ago, the lights. But a big tailgating scene, a lot of parents and boosters and families and students having a good time leading up to the game. They've wrapped the field now with some of the Elmhurst College Athletics logo. They've also added, I don't know if you noticed, Mark, they've added reserve seating.
I did. I wanted to sit out in one of those seats. They look pretty comfortable. That's great.
I was talking to offensive line coach Ron Tyner, and he said it's $40 for the season. That's a pretty good deal.
For the entire season?
Yeah.
That's a bargain. Third down now. Call it 7. Furco. Again, has some time now, finally, and now another flag goes down as Furco goes down.
Well, those young wide receivers out there not adjusting back to the football. Furco got in a little bit of trouble. Offensive line held their own.
Furco Turco sacked by Duffy on
Brian
play.
Duffy with the sack there for the Maroons, but we'll see if that holds up here. See what the flag is.
Shot block on
Elmhurst.
Shot block called on the Blue Jays. The penalty is declined.
Block below the waist against the Blue Jays, and that will the Maroons will decline it.
Yeah. Yeah, as a defender is engaged with his opponent, you can't come in and cut him out of the knees. So that's going to push him back. And now you go from a situation where you're thinking field goal
right.
to do you go ahead and punt it here. I think we might see Joe Furco give us one of his pooch punts here as they let the clock tick down all the way down. They can get it down to about 20 seconds.
20 seconds, yeah. You'd be looking at a 55-yard field goal right around there. And yeah, the Blue Jays are going to.
Yeah, you don't want to maybe give them an opportunity at midfield with a missed field goal here, so go ahead and punt it down. Go to half up, 13-0.
Well, this is an interesting call for Coach Lester because like we said before the game, he was hitting from 55, 56.
Yeah.
And I'm sure Coach Lester knows that.
Yeah, they'll bring out the punting team here as we see Sullivan and crew.
Yep.
Yeah, this is the right call. This is you don't want to put yourself in a position where you still have to defend half a field with 10 seconds to go in the game. Anything can happen.
Brizolara is back deep for the Maroons.
Protection is key here, though.
Seconds remaining here in this first half. Sullivan looking to get it out of the reach of Brizolara, and he does as he wisely kicks it out of bounds. Clock stops with 12 seconds to go.
The punt team's been executing on a pretty high level. We've had some shaky moments early in the season with the punt squad, but so far so good tonight. Great coverage. Sullivan's done a nice job placing the football. Go to half with a two-score lead.
13-0 in favor of the Blue Jays.
Sullivan's punt goes out of bounds at the Chicago 20. First and 10, Chicago.
So out comes the Maroon offense, and we'll see what they have, see what they work with here with just 12 seconds to go in the half.
Well, you have to think with no timeouts, they don't want to take a chance and turn it over. Probably just run the football and get to their locker room.
First and 10 from their own 20.
Oh.
Shelton, straight drop, looking. Brizolara, he's got it at the 40, breaks one tackle, gets across midfield to the 47-yard line of Elmhurst, but just 2.6 seconds remaining.
Well, incredibly gutsy. It shows you why I'm not calling the plays for University of Chicago. That's a gutsy call there as the clock stops here momentarily. I didn't think that they had any more.
I think they had one left, Tony, so they burn it here.
Shelton's pass, good for 32 yards.
32-yard pass completion from Shelton to Dee Brizolara.
A little deep post that time, finding the soft spot in the cover two. Now allows you for the alley-oop play.
Brizolara last year, Tony, had 11 touchdowns. He had a total of 38 catches a year ago. So, yeah, he's the go-to guy for Shelton and the Maroons. And we'll see if they call his number here again with just 2.6 remaining.
It's pretty simple for the secondary of the Jays. Just get back and knock it down, almost like you're playing volleyball back at the goal line.
You don't even want to try to intercept it. Just get a hand, just knock it down. Mark Kruger along with Tony Minestra. We're glad to have you logged on to BlueJayTV.com, Blue Jay football here at Langhorst Field.
Mark, was it the Wheaton-Warrenville game you were mentioning with the Hail Mary play?
Yeah, last night.
Yeah.
Boy, Wheaton-Warrenville South on the high school level. Hail Mary trailing against Naperville North, final play of the game. And their prayer was answered, and the Tigers won the ball game. A sack going down.
Well, that makes
it
easy.
Yeah, Wayne Tuckson ends the half. Oh, and he comes away limping noticeably, unfortunately, for the Blue Jays, but we have played one half of football here in Elmhurst. Impressive performance. turned in by Coach Lester and the Blue Jays. They lead it here at the break by a score of 13-0. And Tony and I will take a timeout and come back for second half action in a couple of moments. And we welcome you back to Langhorst Field. We thank you so much for logging on to BlueJayTV.com. Mark Kruger along with Tony Minestra. We are at halftime, 13-0 in favor of the Blue Jays. We'll set the scoring summary for you real quick. It all happened in that first quarter. 3:19 left to go, a 51-yard run by Scotty Williams. And just about a minute later, a 41-yard touchdown pass from Joe Furco to Corey Tunn. The extra point was no good, and that's all the scoring. It was a scoreless second quarter, 13-0. And now, Tony, the Blue Jays with a chance to get the ball back here, or they will get the ball to start this third quarter.
Well, 9 penalties for 52 yards for the Jays. Pretty even in time of possession. Neither team really doing a great job on third down. Red zone chances, neither for either team. So still a lot to give here in the game. 13-0. The Blue Jays have really felt like they've kind of been in control of the game, but two scores away, Chicago's got to feel pretty good about where they're at, too.
Yeah, the Maroons are just kind of hanging around and hanging around. This will be a nice drive, or a big drive for the Blue Jays. They could punch it in here to start this third quarter. And they'll start it first and 10 from their own 32-yard line.
Well, with the exception of the 51-yard run you referenced, Mark, in the open, Scotty, 13 carries for 109 yards. He's really been bottled up. The defensive line for the Chicago Maroons have done a great job of creating penetration and being very physical at the point of attack. It's really disrupted this running game for the Jays.
The lights here at Langhorst Field taking full effect here as we begin second half. Just a beautiful, beautiful night for football here in Elmhurst. Joe Furco to start the third quarter. We'll hand the ball off to Scotty Williams. And Scotty Williams dives forward to the 39-yard line. He'll pick up 6. It'll bring up 2nd down and 4. Furco, by the way, in that first half, 7 of 9 passing for 114 yards and a touchdown. Shelton, 4 of 7 for 60 yards and
Scotty
no
Williams,
touchdowns.
The ball carrier, picks up 6 on the play. 2nd and 4 for the Blue Jays.
2nd and 4, Elmhurst from its own 39. Again, it's Williams the call. He spins, gets across the 45. He'll have the first down as he gets all the way to the 49-yard line. A pickup of 10.
Well, neither team is very bashful about what their plans are here in the opening moments of the second half. The Jays going back to the ground game. U of C committing 8 defenders to the box, rolling down either Connell or Hill, one of the two safeties based on the formation. So two teams kind of going at it here.
125 yards rushing now for Scotty Williams. And that's that inside handoff. We saw that in the first half, all the way to the 46-yard line, a gain of 4.
Vince Gabridge with the carry for the Blue Jays, picks up 5 on the play. Tackled by
actually a 5-yard pickup as Gabriel gets tackled at the 46. So that's going to bring up 2nd down and 5. We mentioned at the top, if you just logged on, Scotty Williams has become the all-time leading rusher in Blue Jay history. Furco rolling out here, throwing, pass is complete. And out of bounds is the freshman Deagle at the 39. Gain of 7.
A little boot action that time. University of Chicago is really forcing the hand of the Jays on offense. They're asking Furco to beat him with his arm. Going to get a lot of one-on-one coverage on the outside, either in man coverage or a 3-high shell. We'll see if the receivers can make some plays.
Pretty nice drive here to start this third quarter for Elmhurst. 1st and 10 from the 39 of the Maroons.
And here's Joe checking off now.
Two wide receivers to the top. The handoff is to Williams. Windows bounces to the outside, inside the 30, and Williams is inside the 20.
Well, the 10th penalty against the Jays is they'll get a block downfield on one of the receivers, negating the play.
Yeah, I see the flag now. Wow.
There is a flag on the play.
Yep, that will negate a very impressive run by Scotty Williams.
And a good check by Joe Furco. Saw something in the front he liked, changed the play.
Yeah, what's interesting in that first half, you mentioned 9 first-half penalties, not one penalty against the Maroons in that first half.
They've played a pretty clean game.
Yeah.
With the exception of the turnover.
Right, right.
They've played a very conservative game. It's allowed them to kind of hang around. They haven't made a lot of mistakes and really shot themselves in the foot. But
yeah, Shelton's only had 7 attempts at throwing the ball in that first half. All right, so the penalty, Tony, pushes the Blue Jays back to the 35. Furco's going to go to the air across the middle. He's got his man, and that's going to be a first down just outside the 10-yard line. Tim Lindell with the reception for Elmhurst.
Old Tommy Lindell there plays the H-back, and they shuffle in a lot of different formations and a lot of different personnel do the Jays. And that time, Lindell sneaking down the backside of the seam. This is a pretty regular play that Tim Lester likes to call. They run a little play action off it and get behind the linebackers.
So right at the 11, so they obviously can still pick up a first down at the 1.
Big wide split here by Corey Tunn out here all alone.
Give is to Williams. Breaks a tackle, gets inside the 5 to the 3. It'll be second down and about 2 yards to go. Again, they can still pick up a first down.
Well, we talk about records, single season rushing touchdowns. In 2010, Scotty scored 14. In terms of career rushing touchdowns, he's got 34. So he's 7 away from breaking that record as well.
Wow. Well, he's the dot right now in that I formation here for the Blue Jays. Now he comes up.
Josh will get the snap here.
Looking for the corner. He's in. Josh Williams, the freshman. The younger brother of Scotty Williams on the Wildcat and the touchdown. And that's just what the Blue Jays wanted to do, Tony, to start this third quarter with a nice drive. And it's capped off by a Josh Williams touchdown run.
Well, congratulations to Josh Williams. The young man scores his first collegiate touchdown, and he does it on his brother's birthday here.
Wow.
So kind of a family affair there for the Williams brothers. A great night for Scotty, obviously, and now his brother gets into pay dirt.
Extra point by Thomas. He was one of 2 in the first half. Holding Jake Lincoln. Extra point is good. So it is now 20 to nothing in favor of the Blue Jays.
Well, good looking drive there, especially by the offensive line. And you can bet they got an earful in the locker room at halftime. Coach Lester and the offensive staff, none too happy with the performance of the second quarter, the 8 penalties. Got it going there.
Yeah, they sure did. A nice drive turned in by the Blue Jays, and kind of a statement drive, if you will, to start the second half. And they've got a comfortable lead here now of 20 to nothing. And certainly we'll see if the Blue Jays can keep that going, keep that momentum going here now.
Yeah, you mentioned the word momentum, Mark. It's a 2-week layoff in between now and our date with the Cardinals down in Naperville. Obviously, between now and then, some of this will slow down a little bit here. You'll have to refocus in the weeks ahead. But closing this one out strong and having a good performance up and down through 4 quarters is a big deal.
11 minutes. That drive took exactly 4 minutes. Brizalera about a yard deep into the end zone. Dances around and gets it back to about the 18-yard line. First and 10 for the Maroons here with 10:53 remaining here in the third. Out comes the Blue Jay defense.
Well, Furco's now knocking on the door of that all-time career passing record we were referencing early in the game with all the spotlight on Scotty Williams. Coming into the second half, Joe Furco had 114 yards under his belt. He only needed about 200 to get to the top of the record charts.
Yeah, you're right, Tony. He's going to be awful close. See if they can get him it before the night is out. Maroons keep the ball on the ground. Pickup of about a yard to the 19-yard line.
Well, going back to the ground game are the Maroons. Was very successful in the opening drive using that ISO play on the backside. Really kind of gone away from it. They haven't really been able to get anything going in the air.
actually a 2-yard pickup, so it's going to be second down and 8 here for the Maroons.
Giving us a 2 tight end look now, going to play a little smash mouth football.
Shelton under center. Straight up the middle running, and that Blue Jay defense was there to make a good stop. But actually on a second effort there towards the end, may have picked up about 5 on the play. They go back to Ross Nash, number 43.
Ross Nash, the ball
starting
carrier,
tailback. Picked up 5.
Di Maria with credit for the tackle.
A big physical, experienced offensive line for University of Chicago. 4 seniors, like we've mentioned. But the defense of the Jays, which is undersized, has really held their own, played with great leverage.
Big call here defensively for the Blue Jays. 3rd down and 4 for the 25. Ross Nash breaks a couple of tackles. Yeah, he busted it out for about a 10-yard gain and a 1st down. All the way to the 35. First and 10 Maroons here as they move the chains. We're at the 9:18 mark of the 3rd quarter.
Well, showing a lot of confidence in that offensive line is the offensive staff for the University of Chicago. 3rd and 4, excuse me, and going to the ground game.
1st and 10 Maroons from their own 36. Again, it's Ross Nash, the ball carrier. And he'll get back to the line of scrimmage, tried to get off right tackle that time. 2nd down and 10 is the Blue Jays looking for their 2nd shutout of this young season. Shutout Loris, the season opener, 36-0.
Ross Nash brought down by Tuckson after a yard. 2nd and 9.
Actually, they give him about a yard on the play, Tony. So it's going to be 2nd down, call it 9 for the Maroons from their own 37. Ross Nash again as he dives across the 40, straight ahead running to the 42. Actually, they're going to mark it at the 41, a pickup of 4. 20-0 Blue Jays here, 8:10 remaining here in the 3rd.
Very deliberate in their approach. The Maroons here just electing to go to the ground game, take a few smaller chunks of yards at a time, hope for a big one. 2 tight ends pretty exclusively here on this drive, Mark. Mm.
3rd down and 5 from their own 41. Again, it's Ross Nash. He bounces off of a tackle, and on that 2nd effort, Tony, I think he got the 1st down.
Ball might have come out. Officials are signaling 1st down. Yeah, Di Maria met him, but the 2nd effort that time got the 1st.
Yeah, he was met, I thought, around the 44-yard line, but on a 2nd effort, he plowed ahead to the 47 and picked up the 1st down. That's a good effort there by Ross Nash.
He's listed in the program at 5'10", 190 is Ross Nash, but he plays a lot bigger. He's very physical with the football.
Mm-hmm. So 1st and 10 Maroons from their own 47-yard line. Again, it's Ross Nash, the ball carrier, and again, he goes straight up the middle, back to the line of scrimmage, and that's it. It'll be 2nd down and 10 yards to go.
Pretty good play that time by Justin Phipps. He likes to go by Big Daddy, Mark, is what he told me. 6'5", 250, and he's a basketball player here at the college, and so he's still learning the defensive line. He's been forced into the zero technique, the nose, which is maybe not his natural fit there, but he's still coming along, and he can make some plays. He's a lot to deal with because he's got great size. He's knocked out to end here on this play.
Sam Coleman is the wide out to the bottom of your monitor. Number 5. See if they go that way. Nope. Instead, they hand the ball off.
Another play.
Ross Nash again to about the 48. He'll pick up 1. It'll bring up 3rd and a passing situation here for the Maroons.
Dick Maloney and the offensive staff has been pretty content to go with the ground game, but you're right. 3rd and 8 here, you got to take your chances down the field.
Yeah, I mean, you're down 20-0, and you're right. They haven't showed a lot of variety. They've just run the ball, and really, be honest with you, Tony, not very effective, as the Blue Jay defense has done a nice job. We'll see what they decide to do here.
Jays have brought pressure on the pass 2, 5 wide. Looks like they're sitting back in a zone on this one.
Shelton out of the gun. Gets flushed out, rolling to his right, throws off balance, and it's incomplete. Rizalara was the intended receiver. Jamal Lane was right there, step for step.
On the far sideline for Dee Rizalara.
Good series of plays for Justin Phipps. He just made it, forced the play, forced the quarterback to get out of the pocket. Shelton that time, unable to locate his receiver. Good job by the defense to get off the field.
Steven Ritter is back for the Blue Jays, and he calls for the fair catch at the 17-yard line. So first and 10 Blue Jays with 5:48 remaining here in this third quarter.
Sowers punt 34 yards.
Hey, by the way, Tony, we should recognize our PA announcer and our friend, Kevin Jude, him and his lovely bride. Proud parents of a baby girl, Reagan Jude, born July 21st, 2012. I'll tell Kevin that you are an expert at changing diapers, so you can be the number one babysitter on their list.
Welcome to the Blue Jay family.
Yeah. Congratulations to the Judays. First and 10, here's Scotty Williams, the ball carrier, as he gets across the 25 and brought down at the 30-yard line. 13-yard pickup and a first down as Scotty Williams continues to impress and have a wonderful evening.
Boy, I got to tell you, he comes through like a laser beam just through the line of scrimmage. He's got 10 yards before he can blink.
Arlen Hill is the injured maroon as he is down at the 29-yard line as the trainers are coming out to attend to Hill. Clock stops with 5:41 remaining, 20-0 Blue Jays.
This would be a tough loss for the Maroons. Hill's had a pretty good game mixing it up down in the box as a roll-down safety.
Elmhurst through the first two games, you see Hill is walking off under his own power. Three teams from the CCIW undefeated through the two games. Elmhurst, of course, Illinois Wesleyan 2-0, and Milliken is also 2-0 heading into week number three. So Hill walks off under his own power. First and 10 for the Blue Jays from their own 30-yard line. Clock running here, 5.5 remaining, third quarter. Blue Jays looking to go 3-0 on this young season. Furco, play action, throwing to the far side, pass is incomplete. So it'll bring up second down and 10 here for Elmhurst.
Well, I like taking a shot, mixing it up on first down, use a little play action. Kind of work against the aggressiveness of the Maroon defense, always looking for Scotty. Still in that eight-man box.
Furco out of the gun, this time handing it off to Williams. As Williams dives to the 35-yard line, he'll pick up 5 yards on that play.
Scotty Williams carries.
Coach Lester is very persistent with the run game. He believes in it. It's the strength of this team. He'll run it into that eight-man box. He's got some one-on-one matchups on the outside here.
Interesting play call here on second and 5 from their own 35. Furco brings Williams back. And now he steps back into the gun. Hands it off to Scotty. Scotty looking for a hole left side and is not going to find a hole. Maybe a yard or two, but it'll bring up fourth down and the Blue Jays will punt it away.
Well, great answer by the Maroon defense. They've played very well today. Answering the call again and turning away the Jays. But the Maroon's offense has really struggled. The Jays defense has really stepped up tonight. Chicago not able to move the football consistently all night.
Yeah, other than those two play, I mean, the big run by Scotty Williams and then the touchdown pass from Furco to Tun, other than that, you know, the Maroon defense has been pretty solid.
Both D's have showed up here on Saturday night.
Sullivan to punt it away again. Brizolaro will call for the fair catch.
Boy.
His own 36. So I don't think we've seen Brizolaro return a punt all night,
have we? It's been really surprising. I mean, especially in the wake of last year's special teams heroics and sort of what he's been known in this program for the last couple of years and what he's done already this season. He's been very conservative with some of the special teams activity.
Less than 4 minutes to go in the third quarter.
Each team, by the way, punted four times in the first half. So the Maroons come out first and 10 from their own 36 with 3:45 remaining here in this third quarter.
Our second run of linebackers in here, that second set of three that we saw earlier in the game, are back out there again.
Ian Gaines, the ball carrier. Gaines gets to the 38. Pickup of two, second and eight. See the ball resting just right around the 39-yard line, it looks like. Be second and seven.
Picks up 3 yards, a second and seven for the Maroons.
Clock continues to run, just over 3 minutes to go here in the third. And again, the Maroons offensively have been quite conservative here tonight. Again, out of the I formation. Well, just as I say that, Shelton throwing. Seam pattern is caught by Brizalera. Wow, how did he hold on to that? A big hit by Jamal Lane, but a first down for the Maroons.
Right in front of Giles and right behind the trailing Jamal Lane. Pretty simple route. Skinny post route.
Yeah.
Brizalera just made a play.
They've got to go to number six a little more often. First down. They're into Blue Jay territory here at the 43.
Fresh set of defensive linemen in as they're working in. A couple of twos and threes now. Here comes some pressure.
Yeah, here they come. Handing the ball off to Gaines. Gaines breaks a couple of tackles as he gets brought down by Jamal Lane at the 35. 8-yard pickup. It's going to be second and short here for the Maroons.
Good grief. The left side of this offensive line just absolutely collapsed down the Blue Jay defense, allowing the cutback. John Tavish, that left tackle at 6'2", 265. Mowed over Charlie Roberts.
Yeah, he's a big guy over the big number 76.
Brings up a second and two for the Maroons.
John Tavish at left tackle, Mike Van Roten, Matt Gallery, and Dalton Person, all back returning starters. We talked about that earlier. Ian Gaines up the middle, and Gaines has a nice gain, if you will, to the 27. 8-yard pickup and a first down in the Maroons. This is their most impressive drive of the night, Tony.
Yeah, and a lot of what you're seeing right now is not all that much based on schematics. It's going to take a one-on-one win with some of these defenders. It's just right at you, ISO, right down your throat. Someone in a blue jersey has got to make a play.
Make a play, indeed. First and 10 from the 27 of the Blue Jays with a minute 27 remaining here in what has been a scoreless third quarter. Or check that. We had the touchdown by Williams. Shelton looking across the middle, and it is tipped around, and finally it is incomplete.
Ritter had it gift wrapped for him that time, playing the back half. Shelton overthrew his tight end.
Zach Van Onen, the tight end. Boy, a big target, 6'6", 244, junior out of Elgin. Huge target for the Maroons.
Ball just sailed on Shelton that time, and Ritter had a gift. Couldn't make a play on it.
So it's second down and 10 for the Maroons with 1:10 left to go here in the third. Brizalera split out to the top of your monitor, if you will. Second and 10. Well, the Blue Jays were moving defensively and the right side of the Maroons moved.
And you're starting to see defensive coordinator Joe Adams start to dial up a little bit more pressure. Sneaking linebackers off the edge that time.
5-yard walk-off against the Maroons.
Well, we're getting late in the third quarter. About a minute to go here. Down three scores. The ground game's been pretty effective. It's been good to the Maroons, but you start to run out of time eventually.
So Shelton.
Turf monster got him there.
Yeah, the turf monster came up and bit him. Second down and 15. Three wideouts here for the Maroons. Shelton drops back across the middle, and that one's picked off!
18 by 24.
That's Alec Giles. Well, Tony, you said, see who comes up with a big play defensively, and it was Alec Giles.
Shelton's pass.
Wow.
Well, the Jays missed an opportunity. His running mate Ritter on two plays prior. This time Giles capitalizes. And boy, he was down the sideline like a lightning bolt.
So the Blue Jays now with an opportunity to add to its lead here. First and 10 from the 38-yard line of the Maroons. Huge interception. Ferkel, that little shovel pass. We saw that earlier in the first half. Wasn't quite as successful this time to Vince Gabriel.
Yeah, the second time, not so successful. This time back to Williams.
But the clock continues to run, and that's what the Blue Jays want to do here. Final 30 seconds of this third quarter. They want to keep that clock running. Second and 10 yards to go. Furco dropped it, picked it up, handed it off to Williams. Still going to manufacture something out of that play as he gets to the 33, picks up five out of all that.
Well, broken play will be the last of the third quarter, but great job by Williams to not quit on it. Ferko able to get it into his belly and make some positive gain out of it.
And that is going to be the end of the third quarter, the clock winding down. And at the end of three, as we'll switch to the other end of the field, the Blue Jays shutting out the Maroons from the University of Chicago 20-0 here as we head to the final 15 minutes. And yeah, Tony, that first possession of that third quarter capped off by that Josh Williams touchdown run. That was a key to the second half.
Things have tightened up a little bit for the Jays. A lot of hankies flying around in the third quarter, or the second quarter, early in the game. But give a lot of credit to this Chicago defense. They've really held their ground. This is a very explosive veteran offense in the Jays. Averaging over 400 yards a game.
Load up your vehicles and hit the road to Kenosha to cheer on the Blue Jays.
Well, today's game is the second of back-to-back home games for the Blue Jays. Second of six home contests here at Langhorne Field. Blue Jays will also face Augie, Wheaton, North Park, and Wesleyan at home this year.
And unfortunately, those are all afternoon games, aren't they?
That's
1 o'clock
right.
Starts.
Yep.
This is the lone night game this year. And
the Wheaton game, I believe, as homecoming is a little bit later, 2 o'clock in the afternoon. But, yeah, the only night game at home. We'll take on Naperville at night 2 weeks from today.
Third down, 5 yards to go. Tun with the reception, and he gets tackled at the 25-yard line. A gain of 8 and a first down for the Blue Jays to start the fourth quarter.
That's kind of what we've been waiting for all night. They're running a 3-high look or a man-to-man look on the edge, so a lot of one-on-one matchups out there, and Tun takes advantage.
Ferko's pass complete to Corey Tun.
Tun had that touchdown reception, touchdown catch in that first half. He's had a good ball game.
Yeah, he's Joe's most reliable target. He's been around for a few years now. Not the biggest guy out there, but he's able to make plays very quick on the edge.
Split out to the top. Ferko will keep it as he faked it to Scotty Williams, and Ferko actually with a nice run as he gets inside the 20. And they're going to spot it at the 19, so a 6-yard pickup by Joe.
He just left, but he will call all the winners.
Numbers through three quarters, Scotty Williams, 21 carries, 171 yards. Joe Ferko through three quarters, 10 of 13 for 145 yards passing. 20-0, okay. Blue Jays. 13:54 remaining. Second down and 4 from the 19. Scotty Williams, he will have a first down as he dives inside the 15 to the 14. First and 10, Blue Jays.
Here comes his brother Josh.
But what I really liked out of Scotty on that play, Tony, is that he had both arms on the football. He was not going to give up that ball.
Scotty does a lot of things the right way. He sets a great example for these young running backs and the rest of the roster up and down the depth chart. Holding on to the ball with two hands. Get a look at him here with his brother.
Scotty, the ball carrier again as he gets inside the 10. Whoa, so after the play, shoving, but no flags thrown. as they spot the ball at the 10. So it's a four-yard pickup for Williams. Second and six.
Well, one thing that Coach Lester and this offensive staff will do is they're going to give you a lot to think about as you're preparing to play the Blue Jays in any given week.
Well, here we are. Wildcat once again. Furco split out to the top. Just another wrinkle in this offense. Josh Williams will keep it. Sprint out to the left. And he will get tackled at the 7. He'll pick up 3. As his brother Scotty helps him up.
What do you think Joe Furco's out there talking to the corner about, you know?
Yeah, I'd like to, have Joe mic'd up on that play, huh?
I'd like to see him run a little slant route, see if he can make a play on the edge. Third down here, so see if they go back to the more traditional route, put it in Scotty Williams' belly here.
You are right. Third down and 3 from the 8. Furco stepping back now. He'll hand the ball off to Williams. Williams cuts back as he spins inside the 5 to the 4. Oh, my, is it going to be awful close.
He always keeps those legs moving like a little locomotive. He's charging forward. It's very difficult to get him down with one tackler. He's very low to the ground, low center of gravity, and he charges those knees through.
Tony, it's going to be, it looks to be about a half a yard short. Fourth and less than a yard.
3 yards.
And it looks like the Blue Jays are going to go for it.
Yeah, no-brainer here. Yeah. You're up 3 scores. Field goal doesn't help you that much. Even if you don't get it, you've got them buried deep. Look for the Jays to just go smash mouth.
Furco steps back to the gun, directing traffic. Hands it off to Scotty Williams, and he will have the first down. It'll be first and goal.
Pretty good surge by the Chicago defensive line that time, upending the center for Kirkpatrick. Was Scotty able to avoid it? Skip to the side. Get himself a first down.
Joe Tripolitakis was there on the tackle. Glad I didn't have to mention his name too often. Tripolitakis.
Doing a nice job with that.
Thank you.
I'll stay away from it.
First and goal. Blue Jays from the 3. See if Scotty Williams can get a touchdown here. Well, they fake it to him. Furco throwing into the end zone. Touchdown. That is the freshman, Jeff Deagle.
Touchdown, Elmhurst.
Nice little play action. The fake to Scotty Williams, and Deagle was just left wide open in the back of the end zone.
Ryan McGuire, maybe,
actually. Was it 15?
Actually,
I'm sorry. It was Ryan McGuire. I'm sorry. I saw the 5.
Mr. Touchdown.
Ryan McGuire.
Furco's pass, good for a 3-yard touchdown to Ryan McGuire.
He scored last week for us.
26-0 now, Elmhurst. Extra point is good to make it 27-0.
The extra point is good with the touchdown, Elmhurst.
And now the only question is whether or not the Blue Jays can get their second shutout of the season.
Well, we mentioned it earlier, Mark. This game was circled on the calendar
right, as
a revenge opportunity. They realized they let one slip away last year in Hyde Park, and the defense is going to take a lot of pride in keeping them off the board this year.
Yeah, it's going to be very important for them to hold on to this shutout. You're right. They're going to go all out to preserve that shutout.
Certainly a tall task, and not to think ahead as we have 10:39 left in the fourth quarter, but you know, as you look down the road, North Central is going to pose an incredible challenge for you down in Naperville, and what a great boost of momentum to carry a shutout, a great performance into the bye week and into the first game of the CCIW. So the defense will keep it ratcheted up here for the rest of the evening.
And whatever Coach Lester and the coaching staff said at halftime, it seemed to have worked because there weren't too many penalties thrown here so far, knock on wood, here in the second half.
A little
half.
Bit cleaner here
yeah,
in the second
it was,
half. Yeah.
So we talked about, 8 penalties as this ball goes into the end zone for a touchback in that second quarter against the Blue Jays. So they have sharpened things up here, definitely here in the second half. They've enjoying a 27-0 lead here if you just logged on to BlueJayTV.com. Mark Kruger along with Tony Minestra, glad to bring you Blue Jay football from Langhorst Field in Elmhurst.
And this Jays defense, probably the biggest question mark coming in. I mean, obviously had some things to prove after last season, finishing near the bottom of the CCIW in all the major statistical categories. But they've made some changes in terms of scheme. They've added a few new faces, and they've been pretty consistent this year. I mean, you talk about trying 13 points, zero against Loras, and so far no points tonight.
Gains the ball carrier, and Ian gets to the 30 as he picks up five. Second down, 5 yards to go as we approach the 10-25 mark of this one.
In prior years under the Lester regime with Randy Wright at the helm, the All-American sure. linebacker, you think of the Jays' defense as very aggressive, a lot of blitzing, a lot of man-to-man coverage, but they've changed some things. Allowed the players to make a little bit more plays in the open field now and been pretty good at it so far.
Gaines, the ball carrier again, straight up the middle running. He'll pick up eight, and he'll pick up a first down here for the Maroons. As the clock continues to run here, we are under, well, they stop it at exactly the 10-minute mark to move the chains here.
Just in terms of scheme, you're going to be able to get a few 4 and 5 yard gainers here because of the too high safety shell. Defense just has to be consistent.
Again, the ball carrier is Ian Gaines, and he will go nowhere back to the line of scrimmage. And Tony, the Maroons are in no hurry here as they are kind of just taking their time, and the Blue Jays are saying, hey, take all the time you want.
Yeah, they're really playing very conservatively here, going back to the ground game.
Gaines picked up a yard on that play, so it's second down and nine from their own 39-yard line. Gaines is the featured back. He gets the ball again, breaks two tackles, and he finally gets tripped up right at the 40. Pickup of about a yard after all that.
Well, John Elitis on that time making the play, and Mark Evangelista knifing through, and pretty good play by Cody Kaczynski. These guys are flying around on defense. Some new faces out there mixed in with some of the starters.
They really are. They're pumped up defensively. They want this shutout bad. You can tell out there. Third and seven here. 8:35 remaining.
Alvin Chikungle out there as well. Jake Palicki. Some new faces in the secondary.
From the 41, Shelton, straight drop, now steps up, and he'll run with the ball. Coming here to the near side as he gets across the 45, and he will go out of bounds at the right at that first down marker. It's close, and I think he's got it. Yep, they're moving the chains. First and 10, Maroons. Nice run that time by Kevin Shelton, knowing where the first down marker was. Got out of bounds, and he'll have a fresh set of downs. First and 10 from their own 48.
Vincent Cortina, the quarterback in there now for the Maroons.
Junior out of Belmont, Massachusetts. Fumble, and the Blue Jays looks like they have recovered. And they have.
Elmhurst has recovered the fumble.
Well, the Jays have been very good at taking the football away this year. That makes them +7 now on the young season in three games. Winning that turnover battle is a big deal. I talked to Coach Lester last week leading up to the trying game, and he really has a simple focus, touchdowns and turnovers. You win those two battles, you score more touchdowns than the other team. You take the ball away more, you're going to win most games. Pretty simple approach, and the Jays are doing really well at executing that simple game plan so far in the young season.
So it'll be interesting to see how the Blue Jays work it now offensively. First and 10 with 7:51 remaining. Furco as they pitch and getting to the 45-yard line. That's James Richardson, freshman.
Yeah. Coach Lester talking to Tommy Lindell that time. He missed his block. He owes Richardson a lunch or something tomorrow, but Richardson did his best to wiggle out and make the best of a bad play. Well, Richardson sucks. He's got that Blue Jay blue. What do you think of these jerseys, Mark? These alternative Blue Jays?
Yeah, I like them. I like them. Kind of the sky blue jerseys with the navy blue pants. Reminding me of the old the Downers Grove South Mustangs.
Sure. Obviously, the Williams brothers are comfortable in these colors.
Second down and 11. James Richardson with an opening into Maroon territory at the 42-yard line. First and 10 after that 12-yard pickup, and they'll move the chains, and the clock is just at the 7-minute mark now.
Well, Richardson's 5'7", 165,
Richardson,
but a ton of wiggle and some great acceleration. He's out of West Park, Florida, young freshman, and as you look down the depth chart in the backfield, Scotty Williams graduates this year, but you feel like you're in pretty good shape now with Richardson showing some signs here, and obviously Josh Williams in the stable as well.
Nick Ross, number 53, is the injured maroon. 6'2 senior defensive lineman. Walking off the field a little gingerly. Under 7 minutes remaining as Joe Furco jogs in with the play for the Blue Jays.
Well, in no hurry here as the clock ticks down now. Under 7 minutes and the play clock still at 30 seconds. We'll take his time. Talk to the fellas here a little bit.
27-0 in favor of the Blue Jays. Elmhurst led at halftime, 13-0. So it's been a pretty steady, impressive performance, although except for that second quarter where they had just a ton of penalties called against them, but they have righted the ship here in the second half and played awful well. Richardson and met right at the line of scrimmage. May have picked up a yard.
Little confusion up front that time with the blocking scheme. Richardson took the brunt of it.
So probably the night I would think would be over for Scotty Williams. We'll get his official numbers.
Your starting offensive linemen are still out there. It'll be a hard deal to get them off the field.
I know that
Chris Kirkpatrick was really upset with their performance a year ago and letting that game go away. They're going to want to play.
Yeah, I think
every minute tonight.
Yeah, if you're Coach Lester, you may want to keep those seniors out there. Second down and 10. The pitch to Richardson. He steps out of bounds inside the 40, and they're going to mark it at the 39-yard line. Pickup of 3.
Boy, Michael Gilliam. Is it Michael Gilliam? No, I'm sorry. Arlen Hill. Free safety was
Richardson
downhill in a real hurry that time. They're not even respecting the passing game in the Jays at this point.
Third and 7 for the Blue Jays.
Just downhill.
Third down and 7 for the Blue Jays. 5:20 remaining. Richardson behind Furco. Furco steps to the far side. He's got his man. That's going to be a first down. And he's brought down at the 20-yard line. That's a 19-yard pickup.
A Jordan Young out there?
I believe so, yeah. And a third down. Boy, that was a nicely executed play.
6'2", 180 freshman out of the Minnesota.
Nice to get some freshmen with some looks.
Well, this receiving core was one that we had some question marks coming into the season. No Rodney Payton this year. No Joe St. Peter this year. So Corey Tunn was it coming back with any significant playing time. Freshmen are going to have their opportunities this year.
Jordan Young is split out to the bottom of your screen here. And Richardson gets the ball. Richardson to the 15, 10.
Come on, baby Jay.
5, and he's into the end zone, but there's a flag here, and I believe this one's going to come back.
I think they're going to get Jordan Young on this one. He didn't need to do it.
Nevertheless, a pretty impressive run by Richardson, but hold everything here.
Boy, just when you feel like you're in pretty good shape with Scotty out of the game, here comes Richardson darting up the sideline, huh?
And it will be indeed against the Blue Jays. And, yeah, number 20, Scotty Williams back in there.
Holding against the Blue Jays.
Holding is the call. I thought Scotty's night was done, but he's back in there.
Well, it's a spot foul. They will get the first down. But the youngster Jordan Young, as we shower him with accolades, he play later, makes a mistake.
Timing is everything, isn't
sure.
it, Tom? First and 10, Blue Jays from the 20-yard line. Again, we mentioned earlier how successful the Blue Jays are in the red zone. That's where they're at now. Furco, wow, very late pitch to Williams. Ball is loose. See if Scotty can pick it up, and it actually goes out of bounds around the 13-yard line.
Well, typically Joe Furco is known for making some good decisions. I'm not quite sure where he was on that one. Chicago had it played pretty well, ran a little speed option with it, pulled it on the veer, got out on the edge, and the Maroons had him pinned in.
Yeah, that was a dangerous pitch. They're going to bring it back to the... Well, now they're going to bring it to the 18-yard line.
It's like one of those plays you drop in the backyard, Mark, you know?
That was where, yeah, that's where Scotty Williams went out of bounds, so that's where they mark it. Second and eight out of all that. Here's Richardson. And Richardson gets to the 15, stays in bounds. He'll pick up three, and this will bring up third down and call it five as we're under the four-minute mark.
Richardson, the ball carrier, by Tommy.
And at this point, the Maroons are not going to burn any of their timeouts here.
Well, pretty valiant effort by the defense of the Maroons. Obviously, hanging in there against a much more talented team,
yeah,
than the Jays.
Yeah.
But they've hung in all night. They've given the Blue Jay front some problems throughout the game tonight.
Blue Jays need to get to the 10 to pick up the first down. 27-0 in favor of the Blue Jays, and they do get the first down.
Boy, somebody shot Tommy Lindell out of a cannon on that play. He's running with his shoulder square to the line of scrimmage.
He gets tackled at the 8-yard line, so he picked up seven. Blue Jays needed five, and it's going to bring up a first and goal situation here from the 8.
Blue Jays can attack you from so many different ways. Obviously, number 20 is the headliner in Scotty Williams, but his supporting cast has gotten better. They funnel in a lot of different looks, a lot of different formations.
I really like that about their offense. They're putting in a couple different looks. And we've got a timeout taken by who? Timeout taken by the Blue Jays here with 2:45 remaining. So they'll talk it over. They'll have a first and goal situation coming up, leading by a score of 27-0 over the Maroons, as the Blue Jays look for their second shutout of this season.
Well, the Blue Jays will have off next week as they'll get geared up for CCIW play on the 29th of September. Rest of the CCIW does have some action. Wesleyan will play at Hope in Holland, Michigan next Saturday. Aurora will go down to Decatur to take on Milliken. North Park will head out to Michigan as well and take on Olivet. And Lakeland take the short drive down to Kenosha and take on Carthage.
Tony mentioned the other home games this year, but we'll mention them again here. October 6th, Augustana. October 13th against Wheaton. Boy, that'll be a really good one. 2 o'clock start for that one. October 27th, North Park, 1 o'clock kickoff. And November 10th, Illinois Wesleyan, 1 o'clock kickoff.
And if you're not able to make the game, be sure to log on like you are right now to Blue Jay TV.
First and goal and into the end zone, and that's a touchdown.
Tom Lindell.
Tom Lindell.
Like a freight train off the tracks. He runs pretty powerfully.
33-0 now with the extra point forthcoming.
8-yard run and the Elmhurst touchdown.
8-yard run by Lindell to make it 33-0. 2:39 remaining.
Well, 33 is significant. That's the number Chicago put on Elmhurst last year.
Yeah. Extra point is wide to the right.
The extra point is no good.
So Thomas's second mixed extra point of the night, but nevertheless a very comfortable Blue Jay lead here, 33-0 over the Maroons here with 2:39 remaining. Well, Tony, you mentioned, could they finish this game strong and get some momentum heading into that North Central game 2 weeks from tonight? And I think the Blue Jays have answered that question.
Well, the coaches, as they break down film, as they always will on Sunday morning, they're going to find some things they're not happy with, of course. But overall, as you look at it, from first quarter all the way through the fourth quarter, a pretty consistent effort. Obviously, the second quarter had some bumps in the road in terms of the penalties, but you know, the offense has really kept the pace all game. The defense has been terrific now for a third straight week. So there is a lot of good things to take away from tonight as well.
And obviously, as we get into CCIW play, I mean, the teams in this conference are going to see film, and they're going to see number 20. Hey, we got a key on number 20, Scotty Williams. So that makes it important for the receivers and for other guys to step up and make plays.
Yep, and these young receivers are going to mature 2 weeks now before you have another game. So
sure.
From the six.
From the six-yard line.
Great coverage.
Bringing it back to the 24-yard line.
22. They've really done a good job today, have the Jays, in pinning in Brizolara. Last week against the Trine Thunder, Myron Puryear, who was a dynamic return player and All-American candidate for Trine, couldn't get it going either. So the special teams unit for the Jays here in the young season been pretty good. A lot of new faces out there for the Jays now.
Cortina, the quarterback out there for the Maroons, under center. So Shelton's night is over. Cortina steps up, and he'll get tackled at the 29. Pick up four. Second six, 2:20 remaining in the ballgame.
Well, these youngsters now can cut their teeth here in a little game action. 2:14, and we'll see if the Maroons decide to challenge them a little bit, maybe put the ball down the field. But a lot of sophomores, freshmen, youngsters still out there.
That big number 96, Justin Phipps, is still out on that defensive line. He ain't going to come out, I don't think. So Cortina now, second down, they call it five, just under 2 minutes remaining in the ballgame. Cortina drops, throws, pass is incomplete at the 35-yard line. And it'll bring up third down.
Miles Hamblin on the coverage there. The sophomore out of California. Boy, you look up and down the roster, Mark, and this has sort of been a trend in the Lester era, is you're getting a pretty wide geographic spectrum of players here on the roster. Florida, California, Michigan, Kentucky, up and down, Alabama, Tennessee. You can find kids from all over the country, and it expands your recruiting base.
Third down and five here for the Maroons. From their own 30-yard line, Cortina drops back. Gets flushed out here to the near side. Now throws underneath, and the pass is complete. And it's going to be a first down. Pass complete to James Camp. Junior wideout out of Delaware, Ohio. 38-yard line and a first and 10 with 1:30 remaining.
Well, the game's obviously in the hands of the Jays pretty comfortably here, but I just love watching these young guys cutting it loose out here because you know they put in the work during the week, oftentimes not getting reps with the first or second team, showing up scout team, you know, really putting in the work, but they're strapping the pads on and showing up on Saturday. I love to see them get after it.
And they're out there just having some fun, running around. Cortina gets flushed out now to the far side, and it is incomplete. Phipps was applying the pressure, and it's second down and 10.
Wills Massey forcing the play there as well. Great for the parents, great for the families to see their young men out there mixing it up.
Elmer's pressure by Wills Massey.
But there's so much that goes into a football week preparing for Saturday. Everyone sees the 3 hours on Saturday afternoon, but the preparation, the film work, the scout team. You know, a lot of the youngsters still kind of making their way on the team. This is a great opportunity for them. And
second and 10 for the Maroons. Cortina, the backup quarterback, Kevin Shelton, is done for the night. And the pass here to the near side is complete that time to number 47. That's Justin Waney, freshman out of San Diego, to the 42-yard line. Bring up third down, 6 yards to go here. Under a minute, actually 40 seconds to go. Third down and six.
Beautiful night at Langhorst Field. Under the lights, Blue Jays will go 3-0.
Man, great performance, especially in that second half. They really solidified their offense and their defense. Cortina now He's just going to tuck it under, and he'll get hit at the 47-yard line. Knocked out of bounds. Clock stops with 17 and a half seconds remaining.
Mark, the Blue Jays with this win will move to 31-2 in September in the last 10 years.
Wow.
Cortina with the scramble. Tackled from behind by Gore. Picks up 6 yards and a Chicago first down.
Can't help but notice that North Central game's in September. So let's see if the odds are in our favor down at Benedetti Worley Stadium. Boy, it's going to be one heck of a game.
2 weeks. First and 10 for the Maroons from their own 48. Cartina drops, and this one's deflected and picked off. Picked off. It looked like, well, I thought it was, I want to make sure here. I thought it was 25. Yeah, I thought it was 25 for Elmhurst.
It'd be Nate Riffle if it was.
Intercepted by Nate Riffle.
Riffle with the pick. 9 3/10 seconds remaining, so Furco will take a knee, and that'll be it here.
Well, top to bottom, they got it right. Made the adjustments at halftime. Much cleaner performance in the second half. Overall, you have to look at the non-conference schedule, Mark, and think this is exactly what you wanted to get out of your team.
Your final score here at Langhorst Field in Elmhurst, 33-0. The Blue Jays with an impressive performance against the University of Chicago Maroons. The Blue Jays pitched their second shutout of the season.
The final score, 33-0
over the Maroons.
Well, happy birthday certainly to Scotty Williams and the record setter tonight.
We'll see if we can get his final numbers here in just a moment, but with the win, as you mentioned, Elmhurst now 3-0 with the defeat. Chicago drops to 1-2. Chicago will be at Oberlin next week. We mentioned that the Blue Jays will be off next week and have that big ball game September 29th at North Central College. That's a 6 o'clock kickoff at Benedetti Worley Stadium. But, Tony, just to recap tonight's ball game, we mentioned the two touchdowns in that first quarter for the Blue Jays. They led 13-0. And they led 20-0 after that three-yard run by Josh Williams. The first drive of that third quarter, I thought, was really key for
Elmhurst. Set the tone.
Yeah.
It sure did. Yeah, absolutely. And don't underestimate the value of the revenge factor of this game.
Right.
Blue Jays came in angry. There is no doubt about it, talking to the players and the coaches. This was not going to be a Chicago team they were going to overlook.
So the Blue Jays actually go to now 2-0 under the lights here at Langhorst Field. And, Tony, we see over in the corner there the team over there ringing the bell, and I know you were a part of that. And what a
tradition.
Feeling that has to be.
Yeah, well, it's been ringing a lot more in the Tim Lester years than it did when I was a player here. But it's a great tradition. The kids get to rally around it and hope to hear it, four more times this year.
There
right?
you go. So that'll do it here from Langhorst Field on the campus of Elmhurst College. Once again, we thank you so much for logging on to Blue Jay Football here on BlueJayTV.com. For Tony Minestra, this is Mark Kruger saying so long from Langhorst Field. Your final score, once again, the Blue Jays shutting out the Maroons by a score of 33-0. So for Tony Minestra, Mark Kruger saying so long from Elmhurst. We'll talk to you next time. So long, everybody.